B'siyata d'shmaya, we're going to learn Yumud Daf Nun Tes. We're going to start 22 lines from the top of Daf Nun Tes Omud Aleph, almost halfway down the Omud. Says the Gemara, Rabbi Eliezer, Oimer b'mkoymoy hoya oimeid u'machate. This takes us back to the Mishnah on Daf Nun Ches Omud Beis. What does it say on the fourth line of the Mishnah? That Rabbi Eliezer, Oimer b'mkoymoy hoya oimeid. He maintains that the person, and we saw this was also Rabbi Akiva's opinion, that the Kohen Gadol does not actually walk around the Mizbeach HaPnimi when smearing the blood, when applying the blood onto the four corners of the Mizbeach HaPnimi. Rather, he stands in his place. And we saw that according to Rabbi Akiva, this place is the Dorim Mizrach of the Mizbeach. And from there, he goes clockwise around and applies some blood on the corner on each of the corners of the Mizbeach. B'mkoymo yomidu machate, and he carries on. V'al kulon hoya noisein milimato lemailon. All of them, on all the corners, almost all the corners, we're about to see, then he is machate, that means he applies the blood milimato lemailo, with an upward notion, with an upward movement, which means that the palm of his hand is facing upwards, and he's applying the blood, starting lower down, going upwards. Chutz mizu shoyis alofonov, besides the corner that was just adjacent to him, just in front of him, shahaya noisein milemala lemato. There, his palm would be facing down, and he would be applying the blood with a movement downwards, not with a movement upwards. And the reason for that is that due to the height of the Mizbeach, relative to the height of his arm and the height of his hand, if he was going to do a movement that's close by to him, an upward movement, then when doing that, the blood that's on his finger could easily drip towards and drip onto his sleeve, making it dirty. And that's why the corner that was closest to him, he would do a downward movement. The other corners, he would do an upward movement. Says the Gemara, Masnis in this Mishnah Mani, Reb Yehudahi. We're about to see a machlekes between Reb Meir and Reb Yehuda regarding Reb Eliezer's opinion. And our Mishnah that we just read now is following Reb Yehuda's opinion of Reb Eliezer, not that of Reb Meir. The Tanya we learned in a Braisa, Reb Meir Oimir, Reb Eliezer Oimir. Reb Meir says that the opinion of Reb Eliezer is, Bimkoymoy Oimeid Umachate, that everybody agrees with, that according to Reb Eliezer, he does not walk around the Mizbeach, he just stands in one place. Va'al kulon, however, Reb Meir says that Va'al kulon on all the corners, hoya noisein milemalo lemato. Since he started the corner closest to him, he did with a downward movement, therefore he does all the other corners also with a downward movement in the same way that he started. Besides, for the chutz mi oiso, Sheba Alachsoin, that corner which is diagonal and furthest away from him, that one Shanoisin Mimato Lemailo, it's very difficult to be in that position with your hand stretched out right to the diagonal corner, and then to have to go downwards, bending down whilst you're applying the blood, slowly moving your body downwards. And therefore, that corner, he would do mimato lemailo. It's easier to first bend a little bit and then to raise the finger upwards and apply the blood that way. That was Reb Meir's opinion of Reb Eliezer, clearly not the one mentioned in our Mishnah. Reb Yehuda Oimir. Reb Yehuda says that Reb Eliezer Oimir, as we saw in our Mishnah, Bimkoymoy Oimid Umechate, he would apply the blood, he would smear the blood onto the corners while standing in one place stationary. And he says, V'al kulon unoisin melemato lemailo, but in all the corners he goes with an upward movement of his finger. Chutz mizu shoyis alafonov, besides for the corner that was just in front of him, lafonov mamash, shenoisin melemailo lemato, where he does a downward movement, kiheicha deloy nisvon mone, in order that his clothes should not get dirtied by the blood that would likely fall onto it if he does a sudden, or if he does an upward movement with his finger. Continues the Gemara, that we saw in the Mishnah, that after he applied the blood to the four corners of the Mizbeach HaPnimi, he would then, hizom imenu, he would sprinkle from the what's remaining of the mixed blood of the bull and the goat, and where would he sprinkle it? Al tahoroi shel mizbeach. And he would do that sheva pa'omim, seven sprinkles. The question is, what's called tahoroi shel mizbeach? What does this word tahoroi actually mean? Does it mean on the wall of the mizbeach, on the side? Does it mean the top of the mizbeach? Why would it be called tahoroi? What's going on? So the Gemara is going to discuss this. My tahoroi, what is tahoroi, asks the Gemara. Omar Rabba Bar of Shila, palgei de mizbeach. It's talking about half the height of the mizbeach, the halfway line of the mizbeach, halfway up of the wall of the sides. Why would that be called, why would the halfway mark be called tahara, tahiru? Because that's what people say. They say tohar tiharo. When they want to say that it's a clear and bright afternoon, they say tohir tiharo. That means brightness and is called tihar. And when is the day at its brightest? When does the day become at its fullest in brightness? The people who say that it's tahir tiaro, they means it's halfway, it's chatzos, it's midday. So in the same way as tahir tiaro means midday, so too tahoroi shel mizbeach means the midday, so to speak, the midway line of the mizbeach. That's where they would sprinkle the blood. That was the opinion of Rabbi Bar of Shila as we see so far. However, the Gemara is asking, Meisvei, this seems to be contradicted by a Braisa, by a Tosefta. It says in the Tosefta, Keshehu Mazeh, when he's actually sprinkling this blood onto the Tahoroi Shel Mizbeach, Einoi Mazeh does not sprinkle it, Loyal Gabe Ha'efer, not onto the ashes, V'loyal Gabe Gecholim, and not onto the coals. Elochoite, he shovels away Gecholim, Eilach Ve'eilach, he shovels away the coals, on this, to this side, to that side, umaze, and then he sprinkles. Where there's no coals and no ashes, it's clear in this braisa that it's not talking about the walls of the mizbeach. There's no ashes there, there's no coals there. It doesn't make sense. Elo omar Rabbi Bar of Shila, what the Gemara says, what Rabbi Bar of Shila actually said was, al giluyo de mizbeach, on the revealed part of the top of the mizbeach. Not on the sides, he sprinkles at the top of the mizbeach, but he reveals part of the mizbeach by moving aside the ashes and the coals. Where do we find that when something gets revealed, it's considered tahara? Because kedichsiv, as it says in the pasuk, vayiru es elukei Yisrael v'tachas raglov k'maisei livnas asapir uke'etzem hashamayim, like the appearance of the heavens, lotoihar, impurity. So you see that the purity which is reflected by a clearance of an area, that's called tahara. So clearing away part of the top of the mizbeach in order to make space to put drops of blood onto the mizbeach apnimi, that's called tahiroi shel mizbeach. Continues the Gemara, and now we're going to discuss where on the mizbeach there's the tzofa inside, the northern side, which when you come into the heichal it's on the right, or the dorim on the left. Which part of the mizbeach would they sprinkle the blood seven times? So it's a machlekes. Chananya Oimer b'tzad tzfoini. He says it's on the tzofin side. Hu noisin. That he applies that, he clears away and applies the blood, or he sprinkles the blood on the northern side, or the right hand side when you come in of the mizbeach apnimi. Rabbi Yosi argues and says b'tzad dreimi. Hu noisin. He actually clears away the top of the mizbeach and sprinkles onto the dorim side of the mizbeach apnimi. Asks the Gemara b'maika miflegi, what are they arguing about? Answers the Gemara, Marasova Chananya holds, Pischa b'dorim koi. As we saw before, the opinion of Rabbi Akiva before was that the entrance coming out of the Kodesh HaKodoshim was on the dorim. And that's why, according to Rabbi Akiva, the first corner that he actually applied the blood to, we saw this in the previous Gemara, that he applied the blood to was on the dorim side of the mizrach wall of the mizbeach. What did he do then? He then went clockwise, that was the opinion of Rabbi Akiva, he went clockwise around the mizbeach, and where was the last point that he applied the blood? The last point was on the tzofin side of the mizrach wall of the mizbeach. So that's what Chananya holds, and therefore, since Pischa b'dorim koi, and therefore when he's finished applying the blood, he's on the tzofin side. He started on the dorim, he's now on the tzofin. Now you're on the tzofin, that's where you sprinkle the blood. Umar Sova, but Rabbi Yossi holds, and it's not the first time we've seen this Rabbi Yossi, he holds there was only one curtain between the Heichal and the Kodesh HaKadoshim, and therefore the exit from the Kodesh HaKadoshim was on the Tzofin of the Heichal. And once it was on the Tzofin, that means he started applying the blood on the corners on the Mizrach Tzofin. And he went counterclockwise, as we saw Rabbi Yossi Aglili's opinion in the previous Gemara. Where was the last corner that he applied the blood to? The last corner was on the Mizrach Dorim. You're on the Dorim, now you should, from there, you should sprinkle the blood on the Dorim side of the Mizbeach HaPnimi. Tekule al Mamiya. But according to both opinions, Heicha de Gomron Matonis de Kronis, on the place, the side where they finished applying the blood on the four corners, Hosom Yoiv al Gagoi, on that side is where they sprinkled the blood on the roof of the Mizbeach, on the top of the Mizbeach. Maitama, what would be the reason for this? Sprinkling the blood onto the Tohorei Shel Mizbeach, onto the top of the Mizbeach, have to be dependent or at the same place as where he's finished applying the blood on the corners? Omer Kro, this is learned from a Pasuk. The Pasuk says in Pasuk Yotes, V'hiza olov min adom be'etzbo yisheva pa'omim, v'tiharoi v'kidashoi, mitumis b'nei Yisrael. That when you're putting the blood onto the Mizbeach, it's v'tiharoi, it's for purity, and v'kiddushoi, and for sanctity. Tara with kedusha, they go together. Mokim shekidshoi, the place that they finished doing the kedusha, which is the blood that was applied on the corners, shom tiharoi, that is where they did the sprinkling of the blood onto the top of the Mizbeach. Continues the Gemara, that we saw in the Mishnah, back on Daf Nun Ches Amud Beis, that once he's finished applying the blood onto the Mizbeach HaPnimi, and he's finished sprinkling the blood on the Mizbeach HaPnimi, he's now got this container, this vessel with the mixture, the remains of the mixture of the blood of the bull with the blood of the goat. What do we do now? This is called Shirayim, it's the remainder. What do you do with these Shirayim? So we saw in the Mishnah, the Mishnah says, "V'shiyore Adam hayoshoifich al yisoid ma'arovi shel mizbeach achitzoin." That unlike the other korbonis that were done on the big mizbeach outside, where the remains, the shirayim, were poured on the yisoid deroimi, as the Mishnah indeed carries on, but this blood, which was done inside, it was poured on the yisoid ma'arovi, the ma'arovi wall, the ma'arov wall, the west wall of the mizbeach was facing the Heichal, and on the right, on the Dorim side of the Mizbeach, there was an Amma of Yesoid. So all the other Korbonos, they would pour the remainders on the Yesoid, of which was on the base of the Mizbeach, of the big Mizbeach, on the Dorim side. However, this blood that was now coming out of the Heichal, there he would pour the remainders on the base, on the Ma'ariv side of the Mizbeach. The Gemara says, the Omar Kro, it says in the Pasuk, V'nosan ha-koyen min adam al karnois mizbech ha-ktoires ha-samim lifnei Hashem ha-shebo el-moed, v'eiz kol dam ha-por yishboich el yisoid mizbech ha-oilo. The Pasuk says that you should then take kol dam ha-por, all the remaining blood of the bull, and pour it onto the yisoid of the mizbech ha-oilo. Asher Pesach Oil Moed. What does it mean, Asher Pesach Oil Moed? So Rashi explains, Asher Pesach Oil Moed means the base of the Mizbeach that was facing the Oil Moed, that was facing the Heichal. Which base, which part of the Yesoid was facing the Oil Moed? The Heichal. It was the Ma'ariv side. And that's where we learn from the Pasuk that this blood on Yom Kippur, the blood of the bull and the goat, should be poured on the Ma'ariv Yesoid. Was called Adama Pori Shafich. The Gemara with us adds on, which seems to be a different logic, and the Rishonim have a discussion here whether we're goyros this or we're not goyros this, because it seems to be a different logic than just reading the Pasuk, and that is that when you come out of the Heichal, the first Yesoid that you meet is the Yesoid, which is on the Ma'ariv. In contrast, all the other korbanos that were done on the big Mizbeach, when the Kohen would come down the ramp, and head towards and make a right and head towards that corner of Ma'ariv Dorim, then the first Yesoid he would meet would be the Dorim side. That's why he puts the Shiraim on the Dorim. Over here, that he's coming out from the Heichal on the Ma'ariv side, he meets the Ma'ariv Yesoid first. So that it seems to be a different logic than the Posuk that we mentioned, but that's what it says in the Gemara. Continues the Gemara. Those korbonis that were done on the outside mizbeach, they would pour the remains of the blood not on the yesoid ma'arovis, but on the amo of the dorim side where there was the yesoid. Tanu rabbanon. It says in the pasuk. The pasuk says v'lokach hakoyin mi damo be'etzpo'oy, and this is nothing to do with Yom Kippur just yet. This is to do with the chatois that were offered on the big mizbeach outside in the Azora. And it says v'lokach hakoyin mi damo be'etzpo'oy v'nosan al karnois mizbeach o'ilo. He applies the blood of the chatos onto the corners of the big mizbeach. He walks around the big mizbeach v'eskol damo. And all its blood, yishpoich el yesoid hamizbeach, should be poured onto the base of the mizbeach. So says the Gemara, Tana Rabbanan, yesoid hamizbeach, ze yesoid doroimis. We know that this is the dorim part of the yesoid. Asks the Gemara, ato imer el yesoid doroimis, oy eina el yesoid maravis. Maybe not. Maybe that all the korbonis, all the chatois, when you come down, even those chatois, hachitzoinis, those the blood was applied on the outside of the mizbeach, should also be put onto the yesoid of the ma'ariv part of the yesoid, not the dorim part of the yesoid. Says the Gemara, no. Omrus, the logic would dictate as follows. Yilmoid yuridose min hakevesh liyitziyose min hahichal. That we would compare the regular chatos, where the person, the kohen who is applying the blood, comes down from the ramp, makes a right towards that corner. We compare that to the kohen gadol who came out of the heichal on Yom Kippur with the remainders of this blood of the bull and the goat. In the same way as when he came out of the heichal, on which yesoid does he put it? Besamuchloi, on the yesoid that's closest to him. As we said before, we learn it out from a pasuk, Asher Pesach El Moed. Ve'ezezeh, which yesoid is that? Yesoid Marovi. So too, af yuridosim in akevesh, when the kohen comes down from the ramp with the regular chatos, besamuchloi, he plies the shiraim, he puts the shiraim, he pours the rest of the shiraim, the rest of the blood, on the yesoid, which is closest, the one he's going to meet first. Ve'ezezeh, which yesoid is he going to meet first? Yesoid doraimi, because he's coming from the dorim. And therefore you pour the rest of the shiraim, all the shiraim, onto the yesoid hadoraimi. Continues the Gemara Tanya. Rabbi Shmuel Oimer, Rabbi Shmuel says, Zeh v'zeh yesoid ma'arovi. Both the Kohen Gadol on Yom Kippur comes out, as we see, Asher Pesach El Moed, he pours the blood on the yesoid ha-ma'arovi. But not only that, also the shiraim of a regular chatos also gets poured not on the yesoid deroimi, but on the yesoid ma'arovi. That was Rabbi Shmuel's opinion. We're soon going to see he's going to change his mind, but that's what he holds at this point. Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai Oimer, Zeh v'zeh yesoid deroimi. Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai actually holds that both of the bloods, also of a regular chatos and also of the Kohen Gadol on Yom Kippur, is poured on the yesoid deroimi, not on the yesoid ma'arovi. The Gemara says, Bishleimu Rabbi Shmuel. Rabbi Shmuel, we can understand, Kosova yilmad sosum mimefayrosh, that the two psukim, the one posuk that speaks about the remains of the blood from the blood that was applied to the mizbeach hapnimi in the heichal, and there's another posuk that speaks about the putting the shiraim on the yesoid of a regular chatos. In the posuk where it speaks about the kohen who comes out of the heichal, it says explicitly, Asher posach oil moed, put it onto the yesoid, which is adjacent, facing the oil moed, facing the heichal. In the other posuk, it doesn't say where on the yesoid you should put the blood, on the ma'ariv or on the dorim. So Shmuel says that we learn one from the other. Since it's explicit, Asher Pesach oil moed, when you come out of the oil moed, put the blood on the ma'ariv yesoid, we assume, says Rabbi Shmuel, that the same will apply to the other blood. So that we can understand that. Elor, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, my tama. what would be the logic of what Rav Shimon Bar Yochai is saying? That you put all the blood on the Dorim side, on the Dorim Yisoid? It says explicitly that when the Kohen comes out of the Heichal with the remaining blood, it goes on to the Yisoid Asher Pesach Oil Moed. What's Pesach Oil Moed? What's facing the Heichal about the Dorim side of the Yisoid? Omer Vashi. Ravashi says that Rav Shimon Bar Yochai holds Kosovar Pischa Bedorim Kohi. And we've spoken about this a little bit in the past. Rav Shimon Bar Yochai held that the position of the Mizbeach was such that the Dorim side of the Yisoid was facing the opening into the Heichal. And therefore, when you come out of the Heichal, according to Rav Shimon Bar Yochai, what part of the Yisoid do you see? You see the Dorim part of the Yisoid. And therefore, it's not to say Asher Pesach Oel Moed is not a contradiction to putting the blood on the Dorim side of the Yisoid. Tana Debei Rabbi Shmuel, B'Debei Rav Shimon Ben Yochai. In the base medrash of Rav Shimon Ben Yochai, they said over something that was repeated and said in the base medrash of Rabbi Shmuel. And before we saw that Rabbi Shmuel says both bloods are put onto the Yisoid Ma'arovi. And Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai said both were put on the Yisoid Doraimi. Well, let's see what the Beis Medrash of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai heard in the name of Rabbi Shmuel. Zeh v'zeh Yisoid Doraimis. That they both get put on the Yisoid Doraimis. Also the blood that was applied on the small Mizbeach in the Heichal, and also the blood of a regular Chatos that was applied on the big Mizbeach. Both get put on the Yisoid Doraimi, which is Rabbi Shimon's opinion. How can you be saying that in the name of Rabbi Shmuel? Rabbi Shmuel said different. It must be Rabbi Shmuel changed his mind. V'simonecho, how are you going to remember who changed their mind? Whether it was Rabbi Shmuel changed his mind to hold like Rabbi Shimon, or Rabbi Shimon changed his mind to hold like Rabbi Shmuel. So you change the way to remember it is remember the following three words: Moshchuha gavri legavra. People drew a person. What does that mean? That it was Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai's opinion that drew the opinion of Rabbi Shmuel, and Rabbi Shmuel then came towards Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai and held like him. And the Mefarshim ask, where do you see that in the Siman? Tosfos discusses that, and Tosfos says that Gavri, people, is referring to Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, because when in Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai's name, it's his name and his father's name. His name Rabbi Shimon, his father's name Yochai. So it's Gavri, people, namely Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, who drew Gavra, a person. Who's that person? Rabbi Shmuel. It doesn't say who Rabbi Shmuel's father was. So people drew a person. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai's opinion drew Rabbi Shmuel towards him. Continues the Gemara, that the Mishnah says, Eilu ve'eilu misarvin bo'amo ve'yotzin, that the blood that was poured on the Dorim, so don't forget, in our Mishnah it says, not like Rabbi Shmuel, before he was Chayzer, and not like Rabbi Shimon. In our Mishnah it says that the blood that came out of the Heichal was put on the Yisoid Ma'arovi, the blood of the regular Korbanos were put on the Yisoid Doraimi. And the Mishnah then says that both bloods blended together, they mixed together in the Amo, in that stream that was running through the Azara, through the Beis HaMikdash, and then the Yotzin, it would go out, it would flow out to the valleys of Kadroin, and the Chachomim would then sell it to the gardeners as fertilizer. And if somebody uses them without paying for them, then the halachas of Me'ila apply to them. Says the Gemara, Tonu Rabbonon, Moyalin Bedomim. That this opinion holds, that the Rab Meir, Divrei Rab Meir says, and it's actually the opinion of our Mishnah, that there's a concept of Me'ila by the blood of a korban. The concept of Me'ila applies. You can see that if those gardeners would use it without paying for it, then they would the halachas of Me'ila would apply to them. Umoyalin bohen. That's the opinion of Rav Meir v'Rav Shimon. They both hold, like it says in our Mishnah. The Chachomim argue, and they say, Ein moyalin bohen. There's no concept of Me'ila regarding blood. The blood of korbanos is not susceptible to the halachas of Me'ila. That's what it says in the Braisa. The Gemara is now saying, Ad kan lo pligi elo b'drabonon. The whole machlekas is only whether rabbinically there's a chiyuv of Me'ila. And that just means whether you have to pay for what you used. If there's Me'ila, you have to pay for it. But to add on a chaimish, which normally would be a halacha where there's me'ila min ha-Torah, that they both agree there's no me'ila min ha-Torah by the blood, and one would not add a chaimish. And also regarding bringing a korban, obviously it wouldn't apply. Because if you don't have a chiyuv me'ila min ha-Torah, you cannot bring a korban me'ila. Minoa Namili asks the Gemara, what would be the source in the pasuk in the Torah that there's no concept of me'ila by bloods of a korban? There's going to be three sources. Omar Ullah says there's one pasuk, Omar Kroy says, and the pasuk reads as follows: Ki nefesh habosor bedamhi, the spirit, the life force of the animal is in its blood. Va'ani nosativ lochem, and I have given it to you, lochem, al hamizbeach, to be put onto the mizbeach, lechapir, to act as an atonement for you, al nafshesechem, for your own spirits, ki adam hu benefesh yechapir, because with this blood, it's going to atone for the spirit. That's what it says in the pasuk. And there's three words here. There's what, amongst others. One is lochem, I've given you the blood to put on the mizbeach. It says, you're going to put it on the mizbeach, lechapir, to act as an atonement. And then it says, ki adam hu benefesh. The word hu means it is. It's going to stay this way. It's something which is fixed. So these three words, each of these three opinions are going to learn from a different one of these words that there's no me'ila with the blood of korbonis. Oma ulo, oma kro lochem, it says in the pasuk, v'ani nosativ lochem, shelochem yehe. It's so to speak, it's considered yours. If it's considered yours, that means that no me'ila. Me'ila means it belongs to Hekdesh and you stole it from Hekdesh. But if in some way it belongs to you, there's no way you can steal it. Debeir b'shimon tona. In the Beis Medrash of Abshimon, they learnt the sources from the same pasuk where it says lechaper al nafshei seichem, the blood is there to atone. Lekapara nasativ, I've given it to you just to act as an atonement. V'lo ila me'ila, but not to be able to bring you to a place of being chayev me'ila. Rabbi Yochanan Omar, the Omar Kroy, says the word hu, lifnei kapara kelachar kapara. Hu means it's going to stay the same. The status of the blood won't change. And in the same way as after you already have the kapara of the blood, ma la'achar kapara, ein bo mi'ila, we take it for granted that there's no mi'ila, we'll soon see from why. Af lifnei kapara, so too, even before the kapara, the blood of a korban, ein bo mi'ila, there's no mi'ila. And the Mefarshim ask that if everybody takes it for granted that after the kapara there's no mi'ila, why is the Gemara bringing these three psukim? The blood we're talking about here is after kapara. We're talking about the Shiraim, so that's a good question, which Rabbi Kiveg and other Achrayim speak about. It asks the Gemara that you, Rabbi Yechanon, say that from the word hu, just tells us that the status of the blood won't change, and the halachas of me'ila of before the kapara and the halachas of me'ila of after the kapara won't change. It'll be the same. You took it for granted that like after the kapara there's no me'ila, so too before the kapara there's no me'ila. Who told you to say that? Va'ema say the opposite. La'achar kapara kalifnei kapara. Maybe the word who is telling us that in the same way as before the kapara, originally when you receive the blood of the korban, there is me'ila, so too after the kapara, there'll also be me'ila. Because you don't see in the word who that we compare before the kapara to after the kapara. It could be the other way around. Ma lifnei kapara yesh bo me'ila, af la'achar kapara yesh bo me'ila. Answers the Gemara, no. There's a given. There's a rule. Before mitzvah is done with anything that belonged to Hekdesh, with korbonis, some things have me'ila, other things don't have me'ila, and there's a whole mesechtas me'ila for that. But anything that the mitzvah's already been done, then there's no such thing that there's almost no such thing that there's me'ila. And therefore, after kapara, there's definitely no me'ila. If there's no me'ila after kapara, and it says in the pasuk, ki adam hu, that the status of the blood doesn't change before kapara and after kapara, it must be that even before the kapara, there's no me'ila. And this is Rabbi Yechanon's source, that there's no me'ila with the blood of korbonis. Asks the Gemara v'loi, is it so clear to you that after kapara, there's no me'ila? Vare trumas hadesh, and we know that every morning, a kohen would go up onto the mizbeach, would remove a shovel full of ashes from the previous day, the previous night's korbonis that were burnt, and they would remove it and put it next to the mizbeach. And we learn from psukim that even after you've done that mitzvah of removing, of separating those ashes and putting it where it's supposed to go, even after that, there's still an issa of me'ila. And we don't say this rule, ein lecha davar shenasis mitzvosai u'mo'elin poi. No. That we learn from a pasuk that it's osur b'hanah even after you've done the mitzvah, because the kedusha remains on the ashes even after you've done the mitzvah, which is very rare. And if the kedusha is there, then me'ila applies to it. So in the same way as you have trumas hadeshen, that there's an issa of me'ila even after the mitzvah is done, maybe the blood of a korban, even after it's been applied to the mizbeach, even after kapara, maybe there will be an issa me'ila, like trumas hadeshen. And if there is an issa me'ila, how can you, Rabbi Yochanan, learn from the word hu, that there's no issa me'ila before the kapara, like after the kapara? Maybe after the kapara there is issa me'ila. And then there will be issa me'ila before the kapara and after the kapara. And that's not what Rabbi Yochanan said. Answers the Gemara, you cannot learn from Trumas Hadeshen to anything else. Trumas Hadeshen is an exception, and you cannot learn from there to the blood of Korbanos, that after the Nasis Mitzvosei, that there's me'ila. Why? Mishum dehava Trumas Hadeshen, u'big de kuna, it happens to be Trumas Hadeshen is not the only example. There's big de kuna, the full white clothes of the Kohen Gadol, when he finished the Avoid on Yom Kippur, the Pasuk says, V'inicham shom, you leave it, you put it aside, you hide it, and never to be used again. Nasis mitzvasoi, it's been done. That's it, and nonetheless, we learn out that there's me'ila. So from the V'inicham shom, we learn that the Kedusha stays on these clothes, and even after you've done the mitzvah with them, they're still me'ila. So we've got two examples, two exceptions, that even after you're finished doing a mitzvah with Hekdush, Me'ila still applies. One is Trumas Hadeshen and one is Big Dei Kuhuna. And we know the rule is, whenever you have two exceptions, Shnei Ksuvim Maboim Ke'echod, we call Shnei Ksuvim Maboim Ke'echod, when you have two psukim impressing something on us, Ein Melamdim, they do not teach to everywhere else. If the Trumas Hadeshen would have been an example from which to learn to everywhere else, for example, the blood, maybe the Big Dei Kuhuna and any other halachas, that there is me'ila even after Nasis Mitzvosei, if that would be a rule, why would the Torah have to write it again with Big Dei Kuhuna? Learn Big Dei Kuhuna from Trumas Hadeshen. If the Torah has to say it twice, it must be that each one is not able to be learned from it to anywhere else. And that's why, with each exception, I have to say it independently. And therefore, in Melamdim, you cannot learn from Trumas Hadeshen and Big Dei Kuhuna that the blood, once it's Nasis Mitzvosei, there is me'ila. So the rule of Ein Lecha Dovar Shenasis Mitzvosei U'me'elin Boi applies. And therefore we know that after the Kapora, the blood certainly does not have me'ila. And if it says Hu, Rabbi Yochanan says it must be that even before the Kapora, there's no me'ila. Says the Gemara, Honi Chalamanda Omar, that's all true according to the opinion that learns V'hinicham Shom, by Big Dei Kuhuna of the Kohen Gadol, the white clothes of the Kohen Gadol, Melamed Shetu'unim Gniza, they have to be hidden, they're never allowed to be used by anyone, then I can understand, it's called Nasis Mitzvosei, and nonetheless the Issa Me'ila still applies, so it's a second explicit exception, and there's a rule that Shnei Ksuvim Aboim Ke'echod Ein Melamdim Elo L'Rabbi Doisa, and we already learned this previously in the Masechta, according to Rabbi Doisa de Omar, Big Dei Kuhuna Ru'uim Heim L'Kohen Hediot. A Kohen Gadol should not use these clothes the following Yom Kippur, but a Kohen Hediot, a regular Kohen, is allowed to wear these, the white clothes, and not the extra four clothes that held gold. It was the white clothes a Kohen Hediot can, in which case there's no point of Nasis Mitzvosei. It's not yet Nasis Mitzvosei, it can still be used. And therefore, Big Dei Kuhuna would not be a good example of Me'ila even after Nasis Mitzvosei. Ma'ikel Meima, what are you going to say? Then Trumas Hadeshen will be the only exception, and we should learn, the only source, I should say, from where we see that even after Nasis Mitzvosei, there is Me'ila. So we should learn from Trumas Hadeshen that maybe we learn from there that even the blood after Kapara, there is Me'ila, in which case, the question comes back on Rabbi Yochanan, that the word hu, which tells us that before Kapora and after Kapora there's no me'ila, maybe it should tell us that before and after there is me'ila. Says the Gemara, you're right, but I've got another exception, another place where it says explicitly that even after Nasis Mitzvosei there is me'ila. So you've still got Shnei Ksuv Maboim Ke'echod. It won't be Trumas Hadeshen and Big Dei Kuhuna according to Rabbi Doisa. It will be Trumas Hadeshen and somewhere else. What's that somewhere else? Shum Dehava Trumas Hadeshen Ve'egla Rufa. But the Egla Rufa, it says there, we learn out from Psukim that even after you've beheaded this calf, And the halachas of Egla Rufa is learned out, the whole Masechta that discusses it, where in other places in Shas, there's a lot written about it, that when a person was found murdered between two cities and you don't know who murdered them, you measure from where the body is found until the closest city, and the elders of that city take a calf and they behead it, and there's many halachas. So over there, even after you've done what you have to do, even after that, there's still Shomteg Nizasa, and the concept of Nasis, that after Nasis Mitzvosa, Me'ila still applies. There's an exception there, that even after Nasis Mitzvosa, there is Me'ila. And that's Shnei Ksuv Maboim Ke'echot, V'chol Shnei Ksuv Maboim Ke'echot Ein Melamdim, and therefore don't learn from Tumas Hadeshen and Egla Arufa to blood, that even after Nasis Mitzvosa, there's still Me'ila. Says the Gemara, all this is good that you're saying is leman do'ma honich, leman do'ma ein melamdim. For those opinions to hold of this rule, that shnei ksuv ma'boim ke'echot ein melamdim, I can understand that we have a rule, ein l'chadova shenasis mitzvah se'imu'elin boy, and we cannot learn from Tumas Hadeshen and Big Day Kohuna and Egla Rufa. Those are exceptions. And since there's more than one exception, you cannot learn from that exception to anywhere else. However, elo leman do'ma melamdim, there are some opinions to hold that even when it's shnei ksuv ma'boim ke'echot, you can be melamdim. So then the question comes back to against Rabbi Yochanan, that how can you be so sure that after the kapora, after nasis mitzvase of the blood, there's certainly no me'ila, and then the who tells me that the same would apply to before the kapora? Maybe that we learn from Tumas Hadeshen that there is me'ila even after the kapora, and then there'll be me'ila even before the kapora. Ma'ikel me'ima, how are you going to explain that? There's a question against Rabbi Yochanan. Says the Rabbi Yochanan, you're right. However, how do you want to learn it? You want to learn it from Shnei Ksuv Maboim Ke'echot Melamdim? No. Because where would you want to learn it from? You can't learn it from Big Day Kohuna. According to Abdoisa, it's not called Nasis Mitzvase. A Kohen Hedit can use the Big Day Kohuna. So where are you going to learn it from? Tumas Hadeshen and Egla Rufa. If you look in the parasha of Tumas Hadeshen and Egla Rufa, well, you'll see that there's an explicit word there telling us that this, the fact that even though it was Nasis Mitzvase, Me'ila still applies, is only there. And it's almost as if it says explicitly, don't learn from here to anywhere else. Trei mi'utei ksivi. There's a mi'ut. In the parasha of Tumas Hadeshen, it says in the Pasuk, V'som moi eitzel ha-mizbeach, that only regarding Tumas Hadeshen, put it next to the Mizbeach and make sure it stays there forever. Never have any hanor from it, any benefit from it, even after Nasis Mitzvasei. But it's only V'som moi. It's only regarding Tumas Hadeshen, not regarding anywhere else. And by Egla Rufa, it says in the Pasuk that V'chol zikno ha-ira, hi ha-krevim el ha-cholol, yirchatzu esideem al ho-eglo ho-arufa banochal. Why does it say the ho-arufa? To say that the halachas of Egla Rufa, implying that even after you've done what you have to do, Nasis Mitzvase, there's still Me'ila, is only by the Egla Rufa. Don't learn from there to anywhere else. And since you've got a miut, therefore you cannot, don't suggest that we should learn from Tumas Hadeshen or Egla Rufa, that by Dam, after Kapora, that there's still an Issa of Me'ila. And now the Gemara is going back to the Pasuk that we saw regarding the concept that there is no Issa Me'ila by blood. And we saw that there was Ula Reb Shimon, the Debei Reb Shimon, and Rabbi Yochanan. They each brought a different word in the Pasuk. The question is, why do I need three words? V'hanet losi kroi bedam lomoli. Why do I need three words to tell me that there's no me'ila there with regarding dam? Says the Gemara, we're not learning three psukim that there's no me'ila. One would be enough. Why do I need three words to tell me something about the halachas of blood? There's three halachas here. Chad lemu'utei minoisor. One of these words is telling us that the blood was given to you. It's only blood, and if you drink it, there'll be an issa of drinking blood. However, there's no issa of noisor. That means there's no chiyuv of noisor. That means if somebody is going to drink blood that was noisor, he's not going to be chayev for noisor. V'chad, one of the words in the Pasuk are telling us, lim'utei mimi'ila, as we saw, to say that there's no me'ila with the blood of a korban. V'chad lim'utei mituma. And the third one is to say that it's normally if a person eats something that belongs to Hegdush when he's Tomei, it's very seriously chayv. It could be chayv korus. However, over here, regarding blood, if somebody drinks the blood of a korban when he's Tomei, he'll be chayv for drinking blood, but he'll not be chayv for tuma. But there's one more halacha that we also know, which is true about the blood of a korban, but we don't need a pasuk for it. Not over here. Avol mipigul, to tell me that if somebody eats blood of a korban that was pigul, which means if somebody had a machshava of pigul, he intended eating it at the wrong time, or the halachas of pigul, which we'll learn about later on in Shas, and if you eat it, it's chayev korus. Then if somebody's going to eat or drink blood of a korban that was pigul, he's not going to get the punishment for pigul. He'll only get the punishment for drinking blood. That loit sorich lemu'utei kro. I don't need a special word in this posuk regarding the blood to tell me that. Ditnan, because we learnt in a Mishnah that one of the rules of pigul is that kol sheyesh loy matirin bein la'odom, bein la'mizbeach, chayovin alov mishum pigul. Anything which something else was matir it, something else allowed it to happen. Either something else allowed a person to eat it. For example, zrikas hadam, before a person can eat it, you have to do zrikas hadam. So the fact that you need something to allow you to eat it, then regarding eating a korban, which is pigul, that's going to be chiyuv. Or if it's something that is going to be matir the animal for the mizbeach, for example, the emurim, the parts of the korban that have to go onto the mizbeach, that you're only allowed to do that if you've first done the zrikas hadam. So these emurim, the halachas of pigul apply to them. If somebody's going to eat these emurim, he's going to be chayev korus, he's eating pigul. Because these emurim to the mizbeach, or the rest of a korban for the people, they are matil. Something else is allowing that to happen. And the rule is, anything that something else allowed it to be done, to either be eaten by a person or put on the mizbeach, then eating it in a pigul state will be chayev korus. However, then chayovin alov mishum pigul. However, the dam, regarding the blood itself, nothing is matir the dam. On the contrary, the dam, the zrikas hadam, is matir emurim lamizbeach. It's matir those korbanos that are allowed to be eaten. It's matir the rest of the korbanos to be eaten. But the blood itself, there's nothing else which is matir it. It's a matir itself. The dam atzmoi matir hu. Since the blood itself is not nitar alidei dover acher, it's a matir itself. The halachas of pigul do not apply to it, and even if somebody drank the blood of a pigul korban, he'll be chayev for blood. He'll not be chayev for pigul. And in the next shir, we're going to continue the next Mishnah.